want to do the thing?
I don't remember what to say.
Welcome to the Whiskey Vault.
It's Rare Whiskey Friday. Daniel, what is Rare Whiskey Friday?
Rare Whiskey. Don't look at me so like that. Look at me all you want, just not like that.
Not looking.
Rare Whiskey Friday is the day not where looking. We review whiskeys that you may or may not be able to get your hands on. You know what this is? You know what you're doing here? Hang on. You remember Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, when he tries to shoot the arrow and she leans over and blows in his ear and it goes wild?
Yeah.
That's what you're trying to do.
You're trying to throw me off.
Take your shot, man. Rare Whiskey Friday is the whiskey. See, already can't do it. Rare Whiskey Friday is a day where we review whiskeys that may or may not be rare or expensive in your area, but they might come from a smaller craft or a unique producer, which means not everyone can get them. Damn it, I already lost my vibe.
So you took your shot.
Yeah.
Did you hit the bullseye?
No, I don't think I even hit the target.
No, you didn't.
I think I hit the target on like the axe throwing next door. Maybe even taking out like one of the guides.
Rare Whiskey Friday is a Friday. We're going to go through multiple whiskeys, give our first impressions. These aren't necessarily large brands. Occasionally they are. More often than not, these are going to be your smaller craft distilleries without a tremendous amount of distribution. If you should be so lucky as to live in a location where you can get your hands on these whiskeys, you are welcome for the review, and thank you to the Magnificent Bastards that sent the whiskey.
See, that's like going on one of those Hollywood Stars tours.
Right.
You know, the tour guy, or in San Antonio on the riverboat, where the guy's standing there with the microphone.
This is what I did.
What'd you do?
This is what I did. I took my shot, I hit the bullseye.
Yeah.
And then like in the cartoon.
Yeah.
And then I split the arrow.
Split your own arrow.
Split the arrow.
We're doing a lot of Disney movie references these
days.
We're
10 minutes in and we haven't talked about it.
We really haven't. So this is from Marcus Di Napoli, a magnificent bastard, still soon to become more.
Marcus Di Napoli, you magnificent bastard!
Pint.
This is Westland.
Oh.
Now he gave us two Westlands.
Yes.
And then another one. This is Marcus Di Napoli Day.
Okay.
All of these are Marcus Di Napoli.
Thank you, Marcus Di Napoli. Freaking Poli.
And there's like six more up there that we haven't gotten to yet.
Hold on. How are we halfway through this?
There's a good reason for it. Marcus sent all these whiskeys.
Right.
And then he came here to take a tour
with
Emma.
He experienced.
And when he got in there, he said, hey, that one whiskey I sent you guys, I never actually got to try it.
You got to try the whiskeys,
and so I opened it and poured a whole container out, and he flew back home with it.
Right on.
So.
Okay, good.
This is Reverie.
Yes.
Now, Westland is one of my favorite distilleries in the U.S.
Both fans of Westland.
Northwest.
And there's a particular note that I get out of Westland whiskeys. Not every time, most of the time. There's this beautiful, rich, nutty quality.
Like Colombian coffee.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
And this one is cool because with Reverie, it's a series that they do where they intentionally blend just for something interesting.
Yeah.
As opposed to blending to recreate one of their releases.
Okay.
So with all the barrels they have, they just go, hey, let's create something really cool.
Uh-huh.
And this one was released in November 2018.
I think I'm even getting that coffee nuttiness on the nose of this.
Yeah.
Right? And I may be projecting from past Westlands. I don't know. We'll see on the taste. But on the nose, I think I'm picking that up.
This is a bourbon cask, Muscatel refill CS. Refill. There's all these different barrels in this.
So there's the coffee nuttiness, and then there's this sweetness right underneath that is complementing it really nicely. I'm trying to figure out what is that sweet
it's
character?
It's all malt. And it's a multi-sweetness.
It's a multi-sweetness, okay.
Yeah, but this is all malt, and one of them is a peated malt.
Okay.
But that thing that's in there that's not...
So do we know what kind of peat? Did they get into that?
No, but I know that they're in the process of trying to figure out how to source Washington peat, though.
Yeah, but the regulations... Oh.
Oh, my God.
That's
I like
thing.
That one.
That's a thing that happened.
What is that?
That's the peat.
Yeah, but there's something else in there that's like...
It's the coffee nuttiness combined with that earthy peatiness, that dry earthy peatiness.
But then the dry sweetness isn't sugar. It's something else.
It's the malty sweetness. I'm going to attribute it to just a really nice, developed, mature malty sweetness with this kind of like a coffee nuttiness alongside with that peaty, earthy quality. Not salty, not briny, not even meaty savory, but just kind of... earthy and purple, dry, beautiful.
This is one of the most nuanced peat smoke American whiskeys I've ever tried. Did you hear that?
one of the most peat smoke American whiskeys. Yeah.
Nuanced.
Yes.
This is one of the only times I've had an American malt. Not only, there's one other time that was this subtle.
It is, I think it is hard.
While still being smoked.
I do think it is hard to get, or at least in American whiskeys, that smoky quality along with that complexity. It's just such a, it can easily go so loud, so dominating, so quickly.
There's, this just became my favorite Westland I've ever tried.
And with first-hand experience, we both know it's hard to dial that in the process, because in the early process with the new make, dude, like we've made new make that had half of the grain, half of the malt peated.
Right.
You're smelling the new make, it's like, whoa, holy crap, we don't have, where'd the peat go?
Wait.
Did we not go far enough into the tails to pull out that character? You stick it in a barrel for, I don't know, 5-6 months, and all of a sudden, explosion of peat smoke. So it's really hard to dial that in unless you're putting in that time and paying attention. How long has Westland been in business, by the way?
I don't actually remember.
Because it tastes
I think
like,
it's over a decade.
It tastes like they've been making whiskey
for a long time and know what they're doing.
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
That whiskey's 4 years old.
Okay.
It's, technically, I think it's 49 months.
50% ABV.
Okay. There we go, right? This is the next Westland. I got us new glassware, even though it's Rare Whiskey Friday.
Oh.
Because it's Westland's.
It's Westland Whiskey Friday.
This is a part of their cask exchange program.
Right.
Where they take one of their barrels, they give it to a brewer in Washington. Mm-hmm. The brewer fills it with a beer and then sends it back to them.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. Now, this one is a combination they did with Silver City. Silver City Brewing in Bremerton, Washington.
Now, I'm getting more, I'm in more traditional American whiskey territory now.
Scotch ale is what was in these barrels beforehand.
We've done a Scotch
ale. We're doing one right now, but it was a rye.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there were 5 barrels that were in Westland that they sent over. Those were filled with Scotch ale, then dumped, then sent back to them. They put it in their all malt, pale malt and 5 malt.
You know what?
Okay, there's a smokiness more. What is this?
I'm not getting a smokiness. I'm getting a hard to describe unique flavors because I've smelled this malt nose in dozens of American whiskeys. Right?
Yeah, but
I think I'm trying to project too much specialness onto this
onto the Westland?
Because it's Westland. But if I just take a step back and I think about it, I was like, no, I've had this nose in dozens of other American whiskeys.
But there's a woody note on that nose.
There's a woody note?
Yeah, it's not smoke. It's wood. Like damp wood.
Oh, okay. So damp wood and there's that, you know, the little bit of a malty sweetness.
And there's the smoke.
It shows up on the taste.
Oh, weird. Okay, I'm going to follow your path on that, which is, if I wasn't told this was Westland, this is giving me the same experience of a peated Scotch blend, right? Where it's a budget blend that has a little peat in it.
Okay.
So like a Ballantine's what's the one that has the, Dewar's has a little bit of ashy note. Right, and so what's happening is there's this sort of like flat malty sweetness followed by an ashy smoke note.
That ash stays with you.
It does, it lingers.
It stays, That's
but it feels flat. You know what I mean? Like the taste feels flat. Not thin.
Right.
Just flat.
Even keeled.
Yeah.
Steady.
It not stays deep and round.
Yeah, it stays with you.
And I'm mostly used to the deep and round note.
51.2% on this one.
And you can't taste that.
Yeah, it's...
It does feel flat. It feels like a flat beer.
I think it's a double-edged sword being a distillery making some amazing whiskeys. Because on one hand, you are often projecting past experiences of quality onto the new thing.
Right.
And it's like, if you know what the distillery is, like, well, they've made so much good stuff. This is going to be good stuff.
Right.
You're not necessarily starting from... Is that your fluffing technique?
Oh! The live studio audience is rebelling.
You're not necessarily starting from this place of, you know, absolute zero tabula rasa with every single whiskey.
Right.
If you're not going in blind.
Right.
But I think because we just got off the heels of this.
Maybe my favorite Westland ever. Not measuring up.
It's not measuring up, but if I was coming at this, I'm trying to imagine if I came at this completely fresh, completely blind, would that be a really nice whiskey? Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it'd be a really nice whiskey.
Mm-hmm.
I think we'd be enamored with that smoky layer.
I think...
Because that's, you know, nicely executed, but it's not
quite what that
Give it
first
a sip
was.
Again because it's starting to come alive as it sits in that glass a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I think if I was told this was an expensive blended scotch,
yeah.
I would buy it. I would believe
yeah.
that.
An expensive blended
expensive
scotch.
Expensive blended scotch.
They didn't prove it to the floor.
Right.
They got enough age on there.
Like if I was judging that as a more expensive doers,
yeah.
it would get all the marks.
After it lives in the glass for a while,
mm-hmm.
and then you go back, you get another sip. I picked up that Westland, that coffee nuttiness.
Yeah, it's still there.
That Westland coffee nuttiness that I love. All right.
We're so moving on from Westland.
Oh, this is not Westland.
This is not Westland, yeah. even though it sort of looks like it, doesn't it?
Son of a Pete.
Okay, this is Flaviar. You know the website?
Yeah.
That is like a spirits shipping. You get little sample boxes.
There's an app.
Yeah, but we can't use it in Texas because
oh,
they're son of a
Pete.
Anyway, so this is one that they created.
Right.
Flaviar was created specifically for the Flaviar community. This is the second batch
yeah.
of one that they called Son of a Pete.
Okay, so who made it?
I don't know. They don't say.
Oh.
It's a blend. It's actual scotch.
Oh, okay.
Product of Scotland.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? They blended different things. And I think it's Islands, Highlands, Speyside, and Isla. So most of the regions.
Oh, so they right? just went like a big old scotch blend from a bunch of different...
Yeah, I mean, they missed out on Lowland and Campbelltown.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, so that nose is, it's complex. There's some smoke in there.
This is approaching octomore meaty.
I was about to say the opposite on the nose for me.
Really?
Ash? I'm not kidding. The level of pronounced peatiness and smokiness that I would expect from a Lagavulin, from a Lafroig, from an Ardbeg, from an octomore. It's not that, thick and pointy and loud. It's there, but it feels like it's much more baked in and subdued to these other regions.
I'm trying to find a way to that, and I can't do it.
So the smoke is much more prominent for you than me.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I get that it's sanded down on the edges.
Yeah.
So I get that it's not a spiky piece.
See, when I go into like something like an Isla, right, there's no sanding down. It's just like... Big,
yes.
burst, loud,
that aggressive. I can agree with.
Right.
This is sanded down edges, but behind that sanded down edge, it's still a deep, rich smoke.
See, I'm attributing, yes, I get there's a deep, rich flavor, and I'm attributing a lot of the character from these other regions propping up this peat, this smoke.
Yeah,
the density of, you know, you said Highland mm-hmm. The Speyside fruitiness is probably the least...
The
slightest note I'm picking up on this nose.
I need to know who blended this. Like, is it just flake? I mean, who blended that?
Ooh.
That is really good.
It's beautiful.
That might be one of the better blended whiskeys.
So they went five regions, but as peat tends to do.
It took over.
It takes over, but it doesn't take over in this big... pointy, towering shape.
No. It takes over in the oil and the grease.
Yeah.
Right? Like...
It just wraps
like
around
brisket.
All the other regions.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is beautiful, by the way.
Wow.
I like the hell out of that.
I wish we could get Flaviar stuff easily in Texas.
Yeah.
I mean, holy crap.
And then I kind of...
If anybody can find out... 47.2%, by the way. If anybody can find out who blended this,
mm-hmm.
please tell me.
Let us know in the comments.
Because that's impressive.
So, what's the sweet character that you're getting real quick? There is a sweetness. It's like a grained maltiness.
Yeah, but it's...
Grained maltiness.
No, it's not honey.
And it's hard to separate it from the smoke.
Yeah, it's not sugar.
Right.
It's not fruit.
No. Right? It's I think it's just what the regions turn into whenever they're all combined together.
I don't know. I need to check.
Me too.
I just...
Research!
For science... I need to know.
We're researching.
Yeah.
I got some on my fingers. I'm going to do the thing.
Ooh, yeah. Oh, yeah, that's good.
Wow, I got like a baking spice and a little bit of cinnamon on that.
Yeah, totally. I'm doing that again. Going to lunch. Calling an Uber. Oh, whoa!
Did you go deep?
It got Lafroig level
really
residue.
I still get the baking spices and the cinnamon. And
almost, oh, yeah, but I still also get super charred wood brisket.
No, we're on different wavelengths on this.
Yeah, we are.
We're finding some common ground, some parallels, and some things are just on opposite ends.
It's just...
But super interesting, super well-done blend.
It can't be perfect all the time. It's fine. The flaws make you interesting.
Go ahead, keep going.
No, that's all I had to say.
He's going to let it hang.
You're fat.
Here's the dividing, stealing, and drinking.
If you fight me, I fight for a friend.
You steal me, you steal lover's heart.
If you drink,
may you drink with us.